We've already covered the basic principles of operation and the major components for steam turbines, as well as some of the typical auxiliary systems that these turbines rely on. For the remainder of this program, we'll focus on the more hands-on routine tasks that operators perform when dealing with steam turbines. Once you have a good grasp of this information, you'll be better able to operate the turbines in your facility safely and efficiently. We'll begin by describing some startup preparations that are appropriate for most non-condensing steam turbines. These preparations include many of the general startup preparations common for any other piece of rotating equipment. Procedures can vary, though, from one turbine to another, and the turbines in your facility may not be exactly like the ones you'll see here. Your company's policies and procedures will likely dictate each specific item to check for the turbines you'll be working with. And, of course, you'll need to inspect the driven equipment and make sure it's prepared for startup, too. What we're going to concentrate on in this part of the program, however, are those preparations that are common for most single-stage steam turbines. Getting a turbine prepared for startup generally begins with an external check of the turbine itself. Look it over for any signs of damage. Make sure that the overspeed trip mechanism has been reset and is in good condition. The trip latch should hold the lever in place to keep the trip valve open until triggered by an overspeed condition. The governor, too, is a vital part of the turbine's control system and ought to be included in your pre-startup inspection. Check the lube oil level for the governor and replace or replenish the oil if necessary. The governor shown here has an oil sight glass which the operator uses to see if there's sufficient lube oil. The glass shows that the oil level is low, so the operator adds oil through the governor's oil filler cap. It's also a good idea to check the coupling and make sure the coupling guard is secure before the turbine is put into operation. One especially important preparation for virtually any steam turbine is to completely drain any condensate from the turbine and its lines before startup. High-velocity slugs of condensate on the rotor during operation can be very dangerous and damaging. To drain the turbine, open the drain valves for the inlet piping, the casing and steam chest, and the exhaust line piping. Then steam is admitted into the turbine by slowly cracking open the block valves in the exhaust line. The turbine shown here has only one exhaust block valve, located at the header. Cracking open the exhaust block valve allows exhaust steam from the low pressure header to backfeed into the turbine. Doing that not only aids in removing condensate from the turbine and the exhaust steam line, but also allows the turbine to warm up slowly and minimizes thermal shock. Thermal shock is a form of stress that could result from the sudden great differences in the temperature of the turbine's metal and the temperature of the supply steam. This form of stress can lead to metal fatigue and damage to the turbine. Typically, after a few minutes, only steam and no condensate will come from the drains. Then you can close the drain valves and fully open the exhaust block valve. Another major part of startup preparations is preparing the turbine's auxiliary systems. We'll start with the lubrication system. One critical step in checking out this system is determining if the oil level is adequate. In this example, the operator can check the oil level by observing a constant level oiler. He looks to make sure that the glass on the constant level oiler is full. The operator can also drain a small amount of the oil to see that it's clean and not contaminated. Oil that's foamy, dirty, or looks milky, which can indicate there's water in the oil, will probably need to be replaced. To keep the lube oil cool, you may need to put a cooling water system into service. For the turbine shown here, the cooling water is kept circulating through the jackets and the bearing housings even when the turbine isn't operating. One way to determine if this type of cooling system is functioning properly is to feel the cooling water lines and check the water being discharged after it has been circulated through the bearing jackets. If the water lines feel cool and water is discharging, the system is probably functioning properly. Besides draining the turbine and preparing the lubrication system and the cooling water system, you also need to make sure that the seal system is in working order. Any leak-off vents for the seal system should be clear and open. While the turbine is warming up, look at the turbine shaft where it penetrates the casing. If the seal system is okay, there shouldn't be an excessive amount of steam leaking past the shaft to the atmosphere at these locations. After a sufficient warm-up period, which is usually stated in your facility's operating procedures, the turbine startup can begin. First, slowly open the throttle valve to bring the turbine speed up to about 10 to 20% of the normal speed. This part of the startup is often referred to as heat soaking. It allows both the rotating and stationary parts of the turbine to come up to normal operating temperature evenly. Company procedures usually dictate how long the turbine must heat soak before you can continue the startup. After the heat soaking period, the turbine can be brought up to normal operating speed. In order to bring the turbine up to speed properly, the operator must slowly open the already partially open throttle valve. He watches for movement of the governor linkage. And he also listens for the sound of the increasing turbine speed to level out. These signs indicate that the governor has taken over and is in control. Once that occurs, the operator can fully open the throttle valve. Opening the throttle valve all the way before the governor has control could cause the turbine to overspeed. In turn, this would trigger the overspeed trip and stop the turbine. If the governor doesn't take over when you're attempting startup, let your supervisor know so the problem can be corrected before the turbine is allowed into operation. Once the turbine has reached normal operating speed and you've verified that the governor is working properly, the startup procedure is essentially completed. However, an operator's responsibilities certainly don't end with getting the turbine started. There are conditions that must be observed and monitored while the turbine is running. We'll look at operator responsibilities during normal turbine operation when we return. So far in our discussion of turbine operations, we've got the turbine started and running at normal operating speed. When the turbine and the equipment it's coupled to are both running smoothly and the driven equipment is performing the work it's supposed to do, the turbine is said to be operating normally under load. Generally, this is the phase of turbine operation that you'll deal with most. Other phases, like startup and shutdown, occur less often. But making frequent checks of the turbine and its auxiliaries throughout the time that the turbine is operating under load is likely to be one of your routine tasks on the job. In order to keep the turbine running the way it's supposed to, it's important that you perform these checks properly. During these inspections, you should observe whether the turbine appears to be running smoothly, and whether the values of the readings and overall operating conditions are normal for the turbine that you're working with. You should note any unusual noise or circumstance associated with the turbine, its auxiliaries, or the driven equipment. Checking out possible problems early is a good way to prevent more serious trouble later. The operator shown here is checking the level on a constant level oiler to determine if there's enough lube oil in the oil reservoir and if the oiler is working properly. the level in the glass is slightly lower than it was at startup, which is generally a sign that the constant level oiler isn't plugged and is maintaining sufficient lubrication. Adequate lubrication helps keep the bearings from overheating. Likewise, the bearings could get too hot if the cooling water system isn't working the way it's supposed to. For this reason, the cooling water flow must also be checked regularly. On this turbine, the operator can feel the cool water flowing through the pipes into the turbine. If the lines feel cool, that's usually a good indication that the system is functioning properly. He can also observe and feel the cooling water being discharged after it has passed through the turbine. A steady discharge of water generally means that the system is okay. While the turbine is in normal operation, readings of turbine speed help you judge how well the governor is working. The speed for the turbine shown here is indicated in RPM on a tachometer. Another condition that is important to observe during routine inspections is vibration. It's normal for some small amount of vibration to be present anytime a turbine is running. Excessive vibration, however, can be an indication of trouble. Two ways to detect excessive vibration are by listening for unusual noise and by looking or feeling for abnormal vibration at the governor, bearing housings, turbine casing, and the coupling. Your facility may also have special vibration monitoring or analysis devices. If so, refer to your facility's operating procedures for instructions on how to use these instruments. In addition to making these routine checks, an operator must be alert for signs of any abnormal conditions during turbine operation. Regardless of the exact type of steam turbine you're operating, there are some abnormal conditions that you need to check for in most cases. In the turbine speed control system, hunting and overspeed are conditions to watch out for. Hunting, as we discussed earlier, is inefficient. Trips from overspeeding are also disruptive and costly. Although, of course, if the trip mechanism weren't working to stop the turbine during overspeed conditions, the cost of the facility could be even greater. Observing the operation of the speed control and the turbine protection systems during your routine inspections can help you determine if the turbine is running normally. When the turbine's running correctly, the RPM for the shaft speed is normal and steady with no hunting. Also, when the turbine is running the way it's supposed to, it makes a distinct sound that's unique to that turbine. You'll need to become familiar with the normal operating sound of the specific turbine you're working with. Then you'll be able to tell if the turbine doesn't sound like it's running properly. Finally, when the turbine is operating, pressures for the turbine casing and for the steam going into and coming out of the turbine may need to be monitored. A steam turbine relies on the maximum pressure difference between high inlet and low exhaust pressures to do the best or most efficient job of producing rotary mechanical energy. Excessive exhaust pressure is usually a sign that the turbine or the steam system it discharges to is not operating as efficiently as it should. Also during operation, pressure can build up in the casing. Some turbines have a sentinel valve, as we saw earlier, that gives an audible warning when casing pressure becomes too high. And almost all turbines have a safety relief valve in the exhaust line that will open to protect against excessive pressure. If the safety relief valve isn't functioning, other corrective actions must be taken. You should check your facility's operating procedures to find out how this problem should be handled for the turbine you're operating. Well, by now you'll probably agree that an operator has a lot of responsibilities to take care of when a turbine is operating under load. He has to make sure the turbine's being adequately lubricated and cooled, that it's not overspeeding or hunting or vibrating excessively, and he has to make sure that all the auxiliary systems are functioning the way they should to keep the turbine operating safely and efficiently. Eventually, however, a turbine will have to be stopped or shut down. An operator has tasks to perform during this final phase of turbine operation too. We'll look at shutdown procedures when you return, but first, review the material in your text and answer the questions there.